Hello everyone, this is the second part of the lecture on service design and service interactions, and in this part we are going to look specifically into service experience. So service experience, which is the aspect of service design that somehow is a fundamental dimension to explore, to study and to design for. The study of experience is part of the wider field of phenomenology, where experience has been considered as a possible object of study. So experience is an ongoing process involving the phenomenal unfolding of awareness in real time, and the idea is how can we make it more accessible, intelligible, and discussable. And this is somehow what the service designers want to do when they want to study an experience, because compared to behavior, which is observable, and attitude, you know, that can be measurable, experiences are very subjective. No, they shape our judgments, they are our attitudes, our feelings, our opinions, our memories. So it is fundamental. If I have a bad experience with a specific service, this will affect my decisions, my behavior, my judgments. But being something that is inner, is subjective, everyone has different experiences of the same service, I can't observe this directly. I need to go through words and stories. So I need to motivate people, engage people in telling their experiences. And there are different kinds of experiences. We talk about experience as that constant stream that happens during moments of consciousness. And we can see it when we have this self-talk. We talk to ourselves somehow. An experience is something that we can identify as a definite episode, no? A holiday, an evening, a dinner. And then experiences as a story instead is when we are able to tell the story of something that happened to us, and then we communicate it, we share it. And that's something that is fundamental for designers if they want to access the material, which is the fundamental material for our design. So somehow we try to facilitate the transformation of experience as something that belongs to the subconsciousness to something that becomes a narrative that tells a story about a specific experience that happened. So we want to use storytelling, narrative stories, to somehow learn from people, learn from their experiences, and use this learning, these insights, to inform our designing. Sometimes this process on helping people to tell the story is not so easy. What is that affect our experience? No? First of all, is ourselves with our emotions, with our feelings, with our cognitive models, our values, our history, let's say. But also the product, the service itself has its own language, features, aesthetic qualities, accessibility, and so on. But also the context of use. No? I can have a fantastic experience of a festival, if the weather and the social condition was positive, but in a different situation where maybe the weather is not right, where there has been some fights among people and some bad behaviors, then the experiences can be very bad, no? So also the social and cultural factors affect the way I can perceive, I can experience something. It's difficult to define, though, what is a good experience. This is something that somehow we try to define when we want to measure, to evaluate how a service is and being implemented. Now, in interaction design, experience is designated as how well people, the quality of experience, how well people understand the product or service, how they feel about it while using it, how well it serves their purposes, and how well it fits in the context in which they are using it. Okay, so it's very much related to both usability, desirability, and effectiveness. Experience is also not just an individual phenomena, no? Because often we experience something in a collective manner. Think about also your experience as a class, no? The way you talk about the experience, the way you interact with each other, the way you comment about an experience will somehow affect the way you experience it, but also the fact that someone else is participating in the action is influencing the way we experience a service, for example. So co-experience is the process of uplifting the experience to shared attention, where they become part of a social interpretation process that can influence what the experience comes to mean to the individual and others. Okay. After we have an experience, we tend to have an interpretation. It was very good, I learned a lot, it was difficult, it was challenging, and so on. If I share this experience with someone else, maybe the way we interpret the experience might be partially transformed, no? It is a social construction. Why experience is important? Because it's associated also with emotions, no? A functional perspective on service might give less importance to emotions, but emotions are fundamental. Why? Because they shape our plans, our intentions, no? Because feelings are typically indispensable for rational decision, no? So depending on how I feel, I will make different decisions. So we talk about emotional intelligence, the ability to understand, interpret how we feel, no? How we feel, and therefore what we need to do in a certain situation. Talking about experience, it's also important to understand not only the quality of experience, but also what has been said as optimal experience. Maybe it's something that you have heard about, flow experience. It's a specific context concept that has been proposed by Csikszentmihalyi, suggesting how the best moments that people live sometimes are when they are stretched to their limits. So when something is difficult but worthwhile, when they are very immersed in what they are doing. So there are experiences that might not be pleasant at the time they occur, but they provide a sense of participation, a sense of fully being in the moment and making an effort, growing, learning. This is an interesting concept for service design because when we design, sometimes we want to relieve people from problems. And this is one of the strategies. So I design services that are relieving, solving problems to people. No? But if we do too much this relieving action, we might go sometimes in the space of boredom, no? Where the challenges are so low in the experience and my skills are much higher, then somehow the service experience is too boring. The best situation is instead when somehow we are in the middle, because if I create an experience that is too difficult for the skills of people, people might move in the anxiety space. Instead, if this is somehow in between the skills and challenge, there can be a possibility where people somehow gradually develop the skills and enter this kind of flow channel, let's say. Another aspect to consider when we design for service is the difference between satisfaction versus experience, because, of course, the tendency in many kind of research for service innovation is to do customer services, customer satisfaction. But the problem that customer satisfaction is related to single transaction and it's very consumption specific. So how many times we might fill a survey, but we are not necessarily describing what has been really happening to us, no? It's not touching into emotions, it's not touching on motivations, it's not touching on the personal experiences of people. It is a comfortable way to do research because it's very quick and immediate, no? Armchair mode of investigation, but it doesn't help to capture many important aspects of service experience. So in order to capture experience, we need to look into anthropology, and in particular the methodology of anthropology or cultural anthropology, which is ethnography. And ethnography, what do we do when we do an ethnographic study or an ethnographically inspired approach to user studies, is that we are trying to make sense of how other people make sense. So we're trying to put ourselves in other people's situation, trying to see how people interpret their situations, their lives, how they make sense of their experiences. And generally broad requirements are that you make someone else's personal experience the object and focus of your attention. You engage with people in explicit retrospection, recapitulation, reflexive awareness, not the storytelling that we were talking before. You produce some kind of mental construct map of the experience, so the customer journey map is an example of this kind of storytelling where people revisit their experience. And so somehow, by doing this, people start to make their reflection, their experiences more explicit and meaningful. And this is the material somehow that helps designers then to approach the project. To do this, we use methods coming from, let's say, ethnography. So it could be interviews, observations. It's important to do a full immersion in the situations. It's important not to never make assumptions because, in particular, if we enter environments, communities that we are not, we don't belong to, it's easy to make assumptions. It's important to listen and empathize. And another aspect that is fundamental, you will see when you co-design, you engage people in design processes, also the importance that processes should be playful, no? Because this is helping to engage people more easily. And the other dimension that is, of course, fundamental, and you will see probably with the course from Francesca Piredda, is the role of narrative. So generally is fundamental through interviews, through the creation of story maps, customer journey maps, videos, and so on, to tell stories. Because stories are the structure, the sense and significance given to the experience. And so somehow helping people to share their experiences is an important vehicle to start a project, to inform a project that needs to improve certain experiences. In marketing, they use, for example, the technique of critical incidents. So instead of telling in general the experience, they ask for telling episodes where things went badly. So a critical incident is the one that contributes to or detracts from the general aim of the activity in a significant way. No? So something that really goes bad, that is very dissatisfying, or at the same time very satisfying, so it can be opposite way, or something very good or something very bad. Why this? Because then going back to the episode, one can try to understand why that happened. What were the causes that brought to that specific incident and that specific problem, no? And we can have so many experiences like that. So, well, you also maybe coming to ISA in Italy, doing all the documentations, you might have a lot of these critical incidents. Sometimes we use video-based or blogs or online supports to kind of collect stories and make them available in a collaborative design process, for example. This is another way to let people maybe tell their stories. We have a kind of a self-reporting techniques. We were talking about before about emotional mapping, so somehow the fact that you can ask a group of people to comment on a series of service encounter and experience and position their comments in a scale from positive and negative. So this can be a collaborative process that that can also support some conversations and discussion to go beyond what designers have been or researchers has been understanding before. And then there are also tools that are, maybe you heard about generative tools as a category of tools that has been developed by Elizabeth Sanders. And these tools are generally used instead to not only to consider stories, experiences, but really explore emotions, visions. So because they are made up of images, ambiguous shapes, or very open techniques, they are very good to stimulate people to go beyond the rational storytelling, but really try to express how they are, how they feel, their emotions, their visions, and so on. And there are many different methods that can help. No? You can do key informants interviews, you can do a contextual inquiry, meaning going in a place and observing and talking with people. It's about interviewing, observation, participant observation when you take part in the action, through photographs, videos, user diaries, so asking people to make note of their own experiences and so on. So this is of course a space where there is a lot of literature to go deeper in the methodology. I will in particular present you now one methodology that has been very successful in the healthcare sector, which is called experience-based co-design. No? This was born from a collaboration between the NHS in UK, Think Public, which is a service design agency working in the public sector, and healthcare improvements academics like Paul Bate and Glenn Robert. The NHS was interested in the approaches by design because there was a failure in general in applying more change management approaches in transforming organizations. So they wanted to explore this new methodology, this new design-led tools and methods, and see if they could be applied and adapted to improve health services. And they did a pilot project with the head and neck cancer service at Luton and Dunstable Hospital. Why this place? Because this hospital was very good in terms of customer satisfaction. And so they wanted to see if with design they could get more insights and improve it even more. So the process was then formalized in this way. There was a phase of analysis where both designer, researchers, and staff were using tools like storytelling, patient diaries, film diaries, observation, emotional mapping. This was followed by different co-design events that identified specific improvement projects and they were brought forward by co-design teams. They started with trying to communicate the intention of the project, no? Try to involve both patients and staff, emphasizing how your experience matters. So not just doing survey, customer satisfaction survey, but we want to hear about your experience. And so this is a fundamental part of the process where you engage people to participate in the process. And after all the ethical forms where people give their consent to participate, they can start with the research. And the research was this contextual inquiry where researchers, designers spent some time in the hospital. They did direct observation, they did one-to-one interviews, and they asked people to collect their experiences. So they had to do photo diaries, and so take pictures of their life and make comments that helped the researchers to better understand the patients. And then they conducted film diaries, they did video interviews. What is interesting here is that not only the researchers conducted these interviews, but also patients interviewed other patients. And these patients were trained by a BBC filmmaker. So they would be, were trained to conduct these video interviews. And so this material, video material that was collected, was then summarized in a short video that was shared during a workshop. During this workshop, they conducted also exercises, like we said, the emotional mapping, where patients and then separately staff were mapping their experiences along a customer journey, pointing toward very bad experiences when they put their cards very low in the board, or very high where experience was very good. And this is in a collaborative manner helped them to identify which were the key touch points, the key moments of the experience that needed to be improved. So at the end of this process, they identified aspects of the service that should be improved, and they asked people to choose them, to choose the ones that they wanted to work on, and try to define some design principles, common design principles, that could guide the projects. And so at the end of this process, they selected the themes to work on, and they created different co-design teams that developed together the possible solution. Okay, and out of this, there were 43 low or no cost improvement that were dealing with efficiency, patient safety, and the overall experience of the service. And this process, beyond improving the service, was also fostering a better collaborative relationship between frontline staff and patients, reinvigorated the staff in their daily work, and created some forms of therapeutic effect. Now, this experience has been formalized in the methodology that you can find online, experience-based design or experience-based co-design. You can find many articles, many sources that talks about this methodology. Of course, this has been then taken by non-designers, so the interpretation has been a bit different. Maybe this kind of projects lack in the terms of creativity, but it did help to bring experience at the center of healthcare improvement projects, which is also already a very good result. So here you can find some of the readings behind this lecture that you can search online if you want to go deeper. And so this is the end, let's say, of this, the second lecture of this class that can, I hope, inform a part of your thinking, also for your assignments, and anyway for your career.